Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Behold, O God, our defender, and look upon the face of thine anointed, for one day in thy courts is better than a thousand.
Oh, how amiable are thy dwellings, thou Lord of hosts. My soul hath a desire and longing to enter into the courts of the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Behold, O God, our defender, and look upon the face of thine anointed, for one day in thy courts is better than a thousand. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ said, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like unto it, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Thank you.
us the increase of faith, hope, and charity, and that we may obtain that which thou dost promise, make us to love that which thou dost command, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated.
The epistle is written in the fifth chapter of St. Paul's epistle to the Galatians, beginning at the 16th verse. I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. Here endeth the epistle.
Thanks be to God.
It is better to trust in the Lord than to put any confidence in man. It is better to trust in the Lord than to put any confidence in princes.
Alleluia, alleluia. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation. Alleluia.
Thank you.
came to pass as Jesus went to Jerusalem that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, Go, show yourselves unto the priests. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, and with a loud voice glorified God, and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that returns to give glory to God, save this stranger. And he said unto him, Arise, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole. Thus far the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Having a service of Holy Communion on the 8th for the Nativity of Mary. I apologize, I have an appointment, I cannot be here that day. But our weekly communion service this week, and if you're listening online, pay attention, is Friday the 10th at 10 o'clock is going to be our weekly communion service this week, and that will be our monthly Requiem Mass. So no communion on Wednesday. But we will have communion this week on Friday at 10. Today is the last day to contribute to the Harford County Education Foundation's Tools for Schools program. Thanks for everyone who's helping out with that. If you still want to contribute, you can put a check in the offering or cash in the little box, the little container out there. And that will go to help teachers buy school supplies for their kids here in Harford County. And there's a lot of needy kids out there. And do we have a running total, Christy?
From what I just picked up from the last jar, we've just gone over $500, so I'm not sure what else is in the coming to me. I've seen so far.
Wonderful.
Thank you all.
Okay, great. Today's the last day to contribute to that, so thanks for all of your generosity. If you do write a check, just make it payable to St. Albans, and we're going to send them one lump sum check. St. Walburga Daughters of Chapter of Daughters of the King will meet here at church on the 18th at 3 p.m. for their discernment class, followed by dinner at 4:30, which all daughters are invited to attend. And I think that's it as far as announcements. Do we have any, Christy?
Just a reminder to the Daughters of the King, the chapter meeting is next Sunday, 11:45.
Okay, Daughters of the King chapter meeting next Sunday, 11:45.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Any other ones? Okay. We've also switched to our new mass setting. The Shaw mass setting. This will take us through Trinity Tide up to Advent. So we all are familiar with it. If you're not, the music is there on the little table in the back. So there we are. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Today, St. Paul answers the obvious question which follows from his theology about justification by faith, which we briefly examined last week. What about good works? If I am justified by faith in Jesus Christ, what does that mean about how I should live my life? Should I just not worry about living a holy life and offending God because I just believe and I have faith? If we are saved by faith in Christ, do good works even matter? And if so, how? In Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 and 27, Paul writes, "For ye are all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ." Having become children of God by grace through faith in Jesus, we are freed from the dominion of sin. It doesn't have to reign over us anymore. There's a new power within us, the power of the indwelling of the Holy Ghost. In Galatians chapter 5, verse 1, he writes, "For freedom, Christ has set us free." Once we are born again in Jesus, we are free from the constraints of the law. And that's kind of his point here to the Galatians. You're free from the law. You don't need to go back to that anymore. You're in Christ. And then he continues on in this same verse at the beginning of chapter 5, "Stand firm, men, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery." But then he gives a warning just a little bit later in verses 13 and 14. "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free, but do not use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly in love." This is similar to an admonition he gives in Romans chapter 6. In Romans chapter 6, it's the same idea. He's writing to a different church, a different group of Christians there in Rome, and he has talked to them about how in baptism they've died with Christ, and they've risen with Christ. And but then what do you do? He says, "What then shall we say? Shall we go on sinning that grace may increase? By no means. For those who have died to sin, we are those who have died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Our old self was crucified with him so the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life. Offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness." So that's Paul's key thought We are saved by grace through faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, and now we are a new creation, and our lives reflect that in our utter devotion and commitment to Christ, striving to live like Him, to be like Him. He indwells us, and we are made more and more like Him in holiness and righteousness. Well, these two passages are key, and these are themes throughout Paul's letters. But these are key because when some people talk about salvation by grace through faith, it's as though it doesn't matter how we live. I can just live an utterly godless life, a debauched life even, so long as I have some sort of vague belief in God and some sort of allegiance to Jesus, whatever that means. Like, oh, I celebrate Christmas, so I guess that makes me a Christian. Paul says the contrary. How we live really does matter. Don't use your freedom in Christ to indulge the sinful flesh. Don't let sin reign in your mortal body. It's nonsensical. It's just nonsense to claim Christ as our Lord and Savior, but then live as though He doesn't even exist in terms of our actions. And that's not going to say, you know, we're never going to mess up in life. You know, we're never going to sometimes be that prodigal son who strays from our Lord and Savior. That's none of that at all. But the danger with that is, you know, whenever we walk in sinful ways and paths, is that it can become enticing to us. And we want more. And we want more. Our inhibitions can break down. It's like when I go to Wegmans. You know where I'm about to go with this. And I walk past the section with the bulk foods, and I could just get a couple gummy bears. Better yet, if I'm getting gummy bears, I'll get runts, because runts and gummies go really well together. And I'll just keep them, and I'll keep them at church. I won't take them home, because Hannah's going to eat them all anyway. I'll keep them at church. I'll just nibble on them. And then I look at myself in the mirror one day, and man, I really kind of put on some weight, you know? It's, you know, when we pay no attention to how the little acts that we do, it wears it down. It wears us down spiritually, and then one day we're like, we find ourselves like the prodigal son, far from home. That's why we need to live lives of constant offering to God and holiness, and be on guard for just the slightest way that something might lead us away from our Lord Jesus Christ and His great love for us. The spiritual change that comes about in us through faith in Christ and our baptism into Him takes place gradually. There are warring factions, as it were, within us, and Paul alludes to this in the epistle today. The flesh lusteth against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the thing that ye would. So we have this tug of war going on in us, even though we are indeed new creations in Christ. And what does Paul do? He doesn't tell them, throw in the towel and give up. No, he tells them to resist the lusts of the flesh by the power of the Holy Spirit. And he gives this list of behaviors here, which is by no means exhaustive, just giving some examples there. But also the point is, although they are freed from the law, and that's really the issue in Galatia, in the churches in this region, they're thinking they should follow the law still. They're free from that, but that doesn't mean they have license to live however they want. Because faith and baptism is just the beginning. It is the beginning, the inception of our salvation, not the completion of it. And it won't be complete if we are giving in to the sinful flesh. Jesus says in John 14:15, if ye love me, keep. And our motive to put away sin and strive to live godly lives is a spirit of humble gratitude for what He did for us in dying for our sins. And the gospel today is about gratitude. One of the 10 lepers that were healed, only one of them came back to give thanks to Jesus.
It also says that he was the only one who glorified God with a loud voice. I mean, you'd think that the others would be running off cheering and shouting hallelujah, but apparently they didn't. Only the Samaritan did. He was a gracious and thankful man. Well, because of his gratitude, he learned the profound truth that it was his faith that had healed him. It was only because he had that gratitude that he came back and heard from Jesus, it was your faith that saved you. See, the others didn't get to hear that. Gratitude is why we honor our Lord and strive to conform our lives to his. And you see this more directly in Psalm 116, a very beautiful psalm. We see it speaks of gratitude and self-offering in response to God and what he's done for us. It reads in part, "What shall I return to the Lord for all of his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people in the courts of the house of the Lord." Gratitude. In utter thanksgiving for what God has done for us, the psalmist responds, "I am now offering myself entirely to God." And that's what we do when we love someone. When we love someone and when we are loved by someone, we naturally strive to please them. It's the same way with our relationship with God. Good works and godly lives matter. They are proof of our conversion and our faith in God and our love for him, among other things. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, Paul says, "If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." We are new creations in Christ, so we live our lives now entirely for him and consecrate our lives and every action, every moment of the day to him as an offering of thanksgiving and love. And this is supremely symbolized and reified in our celebration of the Most Holy Eucharist. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with our spirit.
The angel of the Lord tarrieth round about them that fear him, and delivereth them. O taste and see how gracious the Lord is. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven.
Thank you.
offer the Holy Eucharist to the praise, honor, and glory of God for all of those on our parish prayer list, those whom we mention in the secrecy of our hearts, and for all the faithful departed in Christ. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let light perpetual shine upon them. May the souls of the faithful departed through the mercies of God rest in peace.
Amen.
Pray, brethren, that this my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord receive this sacrifice at thy hands, to the praise and glory of his name, both to our benefit and that of all his holy church. Amen.
Be favorable, O Lord, to thy people, be favorable unto their offerings, that being well pleased with this oblation, thou mayest give us pardon and grant us our petitions, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to accept our alms and oblations and to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal Church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord. And grant that all those who do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word and live in unity and godly love. We beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, that they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Ye who do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to your comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God, devoutly kneeling. Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all those who with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear what comfortable words our Savior Christ saith unto all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul said. This is a true saying, and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John said. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
Servants do celebrate and bake here before thy divine majesty with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make. Having in remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most hearty thanks for the innumerable benefits procured unto us by the same. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, and of thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that, by the merit and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. Here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, and made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And although we are unworthy, through our manifold sins, to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee. O Father, almighty world without end.
Amen.
Let us pray. And now, as our Savior Christ hath taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
therefore, gracious Lord, so to
body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which is given for me, preserved by our body and soul, the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for me, preserved by our body and soul, preserved by our body and soul, body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for me, preserved by body and soul, unto everlasting life. The body of our Lord Lay my hand upon me. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee
for that thou hast vouchsafed to lead us, who have duly received these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
We beseech thee, O Lord, that we who have received the heavenly sacraments may thereby grow in grace to the attainment of our eternal redemption, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Keep hearts in peace.
Thanks be to God.
The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and be